I think we're ready to begin. Thank you. So this afternoon, we've got three for the price of one. I'll start in reverse order, because Professor Sarah Coakley will be speaking third in this trio, this triangle. And after a very distinguished career teaching in the UK and in the US, from 2007, she has been the Norris Hulse Professor of Divinity in the University of Cambridge. This is a very old professorship indeed. It goes back to the 18th century, and she is, in fact, the first woman to hold this post of the Norris Hulse Professorship. And it seems entirely appropriate in a conference dedicated to Teresa of Avila and her interests. Some of you, I'm sure many of you, have read her books in systematic theology, the philosophy of religion, and feminist theory. The person who will speak second is Dr. Edward Howells, Eddie Howells, who is the Dean of Postgraduate Studies in Heathrop College in London, and his interests are in Western mysticism in the later medieval and early modern period, and I'm sure many people here will be familiar with his very significant study of the mystical self in John of the Cross and Teresa of Avila. He has carried the additional burden of being one of my co-supervisors for my thesis. And I think I was your first PhD? No. I was his first PhD, his first successful PhD. Which, if you're looking at my... if you're looking at his age and my age, relatively, it says a lot more about him than it does about me, doesn't it? There you go. You're never too old, I suppose, in my case. And to speak first is Professor Peter Tyler, who is the Professor of Pastoral Theology and Spirituality here in St Mary's University, and also the Director of a Research Centre for Initiatives in Spirituality and Reconciliation. A joining together of the theory and the practice in many cases. His interests also obviously in pre-modern mysticism and post-modern mysticism, and the interface between philosophy and psychology. And I have had the great pleasure of working with Peter very recently, because one of Peter's other roles was to be, or finished now, was the liaison between St Mary's University and the Pontifical Beda College in Rome, which trains older candidates for the Roman Catholic priesthood and whose qualifications are validated by St Mary's. So Peter came across at least twice a year to visit us in the Beda and check out our programs and exam boards and so on and so forth. So it's a great pleasure for me to introduce him as both former colleagues. He's no longer the liaison, and under strict instructions from Peter, and I really do mean this, he said, would you just say something about yourself? Because otherwise we'll have to have the introducer of the introducer of the introducer, and we'll never finish this session ever again. So my name is Kevin Alden, and I know that because it says it here. Like Descartes, it's the only short thing I'm sure of. And as you just heard, I used to work in Rome for the last 14 years. And one of the reasons I mentioned the project on Mount Carmel this morning is that one of my day jobs was as the general bursar of the Carmelite order at that time. But I also was teaching in the Beda College, and I'm now back in England in the Friars in Aylesford in Kent. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Peter to open the batting.
Thank you very much, Kevin, for that generous introduction. We have just under an hour and a half, so that's, I'm sure it will fly by. And the way that the three of us have divvied this up is that I'm going to start the batting, as Kevin says, with a half hour session, introducing some of the key themes on why I think that Teresa is a master of the negative way. Now, obviously, that's some of what we're going to do this afternoon will require a certain amount of delving into the Dionysian tradition. And as luck would have it, we have one of the world experts here in the shape of Professor Vernon McGinn. So hopefully, as the conversation unfolds, we can hear some of his views as well. After I've done that, then I'm going to hand the baton, to sort of sporting metaphors for St. Mary's, I'm going to hand the baton on to Eddie, and he's going to talk for about 20 minutes, I think, giving his views. And then he'll hand the baton on to Sarah, we'll then talk for 10 minutes, and then we'll have a little conversation amongst ourselves, and then we'll open it up. So that's the batting order. So I'm first at the crease, and here we go. In book four of the... I've gone for a PowerPoint as well, because my students here at St. Mary's, if I don't do a PowerPoint, they don't think it's a lecture. So I have to do this, so I've sort of been indoctrinated into doing it. But what I've done is I've put the main quotes that I'm using up there, so you can have a look at them as I go. In book four of the Book of the Life that we heard about this morning, Teresa describes the crucial encounter she had with her uncle Pedro during the time of physical, emotional and spiritual crisis that, again, we heard about this morning. And she wrote, "When I was on my way, that uncle of mine I mentioned, who lived along the road, gave me a book. It is called The Third Spiritual Alphabet and endeavours to teach the practice of recollection. And so I was very happy with this book and resolved to follow the path with all my strength. For, during the 20 years after this period of which I am speaking, I did not find a master, I mean a confessor, who understood me even though I looked for one." Her uncle was clearly a wise spiritual director. In giving the young woman a Sumerian text, he was effectively placing in her hands a primer of late medieval theologian mystical theology. And by studying it, Teresa was thus able to gain a grounding in the tradition denied her by her inability, unlike John of the Cross, to study theology at university. Ultimately, and I'm not going to go, hopefully, into too much backstory as to the nature of the mystical theology, but ultimately, when I talk about mystical theology, I'm talking about that tradition that we can trace back to the Parisian schools of the 12th, 13th century that arose around the abbeys of Saint-Denis and Saint-Victor, and the group of writers and commentators who took particular interest in the Dionysian corpus, which was then in the process of being retranslated by theologians such as Saracenus and Robert Grosseteste. So obviously key here is the rediscovery and reappropriation of the Dionysian texts in the Western tradition. In his book, The Harvest of Mysticism in Medieval Germany, Professor McGinn continues the long-established distinction between affective and intellective Dionysianism as a way of distinguishing the Rhenish interpretation of the Areopagite, originating with St. Albert the Great, and the Parisian schools that I've just mentioned. The Parisians, including writers such as Thomas Gallus, Vercelliensis, according to McGinn, quote, attempt to see the Dionysian writings as the theoretical or speculative side of the practical theology of mystical joining with God described in the Song of Songs. Thus reinterpreting the Dionysian, quote, mystical assent to union in terms of the superiority of an experience of affective love beyond cognition. In making such a distinction, McGinn and other commentators such as Rorum do not want to suggest there is no role in the Dionysian assent for love or eros, but rather that the new 12th century Victorian interpretation
will incorporate a more psychological perspective with emphases on aspects of the soul, such as we find in Gallus's writings, such as the apex affectionis. Returning then to Teresa and how we might understand the use of the Dionysian corpus in her writings, I would like to propose in this paper that we need to once again return to that late medieval twilight world, lying somewhere between the affective and the intellective. If we are to adequately represent the tradition of negative theology within which she is working. To this end, my argument is I would like to suggest that the most helpful way of understanding Teresa's Dionysianism and ultimately her negative theology is to categorise it as neither intellective or affective Dionysianism, but rather what I would like to call Gersonian Dionysianism. There you are, that's a long one. Let's say a little bit then about Jean Gerson. He's one of the key figures who is influencing Osuna, who will then influence Teresa. One of the key references in Osuna's third spiritual alphabet, he is one of the most frequently quoted authors in the book, with about 50 named references and numerous unnamed allusions, is the erstwhile Chancellor of Paris University, Jean Gerson, who lived from 1363 to 1429. Recent commentators such as Maguire have sought to expose Gerson's wide-ranging influence on a variety of late medieval and early modern spiritual writers, including, amongst others, Martin Luther, Erasmus, García de Cisneros, and thence Ignatius Loyola, and the whole movement of Devotio Moderna, Conciliarism, which we heard about this morning, and other proto-reform movements in the late 15th century. As far as I know, and I'm happy to be corrected, there has not been, in English at least, an attempt to trace the mystical affinity between Gerson's system and Teresa's. Really, if I can give a little backstory here, when I was thinking about this paper at the beginning of the year, the reason it arose is I was reading Teresa's writing, and when this Teresian year began a year ago, I thought, am I going to find enough to write about Teresa? What new things can I say about Teresa? I've already done a book about her, two books on her. But what has been extraordinary is the more I read her, as was said this morning, the more extraordinary she becomes. And as I was reading her text earlier on this year, I noticed strong similarities with Gerson. So much so I kept cross-referencing between Teresa and Gerson, Gerson and Teresa. And that's really what was the inspiration of this paper. For the sake of convenience, because time is limited, I'd like to sketch what I see as six key characteristics of Gerson's Dionysianism as I relate them to Teresa's work. In doing so, I shall draw primarily upon the mystical theology, speculative and practical texts of Gerson and his Mountain of Contemplation. Versions of both of which, and if you want more detail, then give it in the questions afterwards, were circulating in early 16th century Spain. I shall finish by highlighting the similarities between the two writers and their essential differences, before reaching my final conclusions. So, the first aspect of the Gersonian Dionysianism, I'm going to have to find a more catchy name for it, but anyway, is this one. The language of mystical theology is simple and untechnical, open to all. One clear commonality between Gerson and Teresa is that both of them insist on the importance of simplicity in our approach to the spiritual life. Teresa, as we know from this morning, is very conscious of her style, calling it, quote, my rough style, mi grossero, rather than that of those more elegant. Her imperfection and poverty, as she calls it. Alison Piers, the great 20th century commentator on Teresa, points out in his essay, St. Teresa's Style, that the keynote in her style is down-to-earthness and naturalness. And as I said this morning, that as I think Professor McGinn said this morning, that gives us a dilemma in terms of interpretation. Do we just say, oh, well, she wasn't very good at writing, or she was a bit simple, or do we say, actually, she was highly intelligent and she knew what she was doing? As the years go by and I become more and more acquainted with her work, I do tend more to the latter answer rather than the former. And here, I think, she reveals her debt to Osuna and the simple direct style of his third spiritual alphabet, which is also a direct inheritance from Gerson. For example, she states that the manner of writing, like talking, adopted by nuns, remember the sisters in the front row, should be simple, frank and devout, rather like that of hermits and people who live in retirement. They mustn't use none of the newfangled words, affectations, I think people call them, which are current in a world always eager for newfangled things. In all circumstances, let them give preference to common expressions rather than to unusual ones, which is something I'm always telling my students, and they always ignore me on this one. She avoids learned words, and her text is notable for the lack of precise theological terms, especially concerning mystical theology. Indeed, the somewhat technical word mystical theology is only used a handful of times in the Book of the Life, in the treatise we heard about this morning. Interestingly enough, she spells it differently almost every time she uses it, before she drops the term and never uses it again. Now, because she's not using the term, that's not to say she's completely imbued in the tradition of mystical theology. Likewise, the Chancellor is at pains to stress the importance of the vernacular in his approach to the spiritual life. At the beginning of the Mountain of Contemplation, he explains himself why he has chosen to write in French rather than Latin. Some people will wonder and ask why, in a matter so lofty as that of the contemplative life, I choose to write in French rather than Latin, and more to women than to men. They will say that such a subject is not appropriate for ordinary people who have no Latin. To this challenge, I respond that the matter has been dealt with in Latin. Clerics who know Latin can make use of such texts, but it is different for ordinary people. Thus, as with Teresa, we have in Gerson a self-conscious decision to make the lofty business of the theologian mystical accessible to all, even to women. I'm going to move on, because I don't want to... Yes, that's the quote I just gave you there. To my second point. Scholastic speculative theology may be unhelpful. One of the key elements of Osuna's structure in the third spiritual alphabet that so influenced Teresa is the division he makes in chapter 6 between the theologia speculativa and the theologia mystica. For Osuna, the theologia speculativa uses reasoning, argumentation, discourse, and probability, as do the other sciences. It is called scholastic theology, and it's incidentally, if you go and do a theology degree in most British universities today, this is what you're going to get, what he calls the theologia speculativa, scholastic theology, which means it is of learned people, letrados, and if someone wishes to excel in it, he needs the learning tools required to excel in any science, a good mind, continual exercise, books, time, attentiveness, and a learned teacher to study under. The other theologia, however, the theologia mystica, he writes, is unlike other sciences or learning, for it is a hidden theology, escondida, that is totally unlike any other branch of learning. It is pursued not through learning books and teachers, but, quote, through pious love and exercising moral virtue. No book can teach it, including, he says, his own. He writes, I do not presume to teach it in this alphabet, nor can any mortal do so. For Christ reserves to himself the ministry of secretly teaching the hearts where that theology lives hidden like divine science, more excellent by far than the other theology known as speculative. Teresa's own ambiguous position towards the lettre d'os was well known, and she is often at pains to point out the dead ends to which too much speculative knowledge leads. She writes, and I'm sure we'll hear more about this from Gillian Algren on Saturday, "As for a poor woman, mujercita, like myself, a weak and irresolute creature, it seems right that the Lord should lead me on with favours, regalos, as he now does, in order that I may bear certain afflictions with which he has been pleased to burden me. But when I hear servants of God, men of weight, learning and understanding, worrying so much because he is not giving them devotion, it makes me sick to listen to them. They should realise that since the Lord does not give it to them, they do not need it." Teresa's identification of herself as a mujercita, a little woman, places her firmly in the Gersonian tradition of the, quote, poor and unlettered, the even women that we heard earlier, who can grasp the theologia mystica rather than the theologia speculativa. Dionysius had distinguished the knowing that comes from disputation and the esoteric sciences of theology from the knowing that comes from the mystical initiation. He considered both to be essential for good theological practice. I'm not going to dwell on that quote, I'll just flash that up. That's from the Epistle number 9. Dionysius' rather balanced view in this respect contrasts with Gerson's, or at least the early and middle period in Gerson. Of course, Gerson, like Augustine, Teresa, and everybody else, does change his opinion as he goes on. Gerson goes to great lengths to disparage the puffed-up intellectual pride of the university theologians. I must admit, I do empathise with these passages. "Scholars, especially theologians," he writes, "should give themselves over to a great deal of contemplation. Otherwise, their knowledge will not help them, but will puff them up and make them vain, empty, and arrogant. Indeed, much advanced scholarship and great learning in God's law may be quite suitable for the person who wishes to come to the height of contemplation. Nevertheless, sometimes such knowledge blocks their pursuit. Learning in itself is not a problem. Rather, it is the arrogance and self-inflation that the learned person derives from the knowledge." My third point is on wisdom and knowledge, sapientia and scientia. Mirroring his dichotomy between mystical and speculative theology, Gerson makes a distinction between what he calls wisdom, sapientia, and knowledge, scientia. "The acquisition of scientia, knowledge, quote, which seeks through reason based on the true faith, the nature of God and his being and all his works, unquote, is not for ordinary people, except through divine inspiration or a unique miracle, as happened to the apostles." Put that in. "This will be the realm of the academic theologian. Rather," he says, "ordinary people have before them the possibility of wisdom as taught in the books of mystical theology by Saint-Denis of France. Knowledge will be given to the intellectus, the entendement, and wisdom to the affectus, the affection." Teresa herself clearly struggled with what we would nowadays call an overactive mind. And nowhere is this better described than in the central mansions of the interior castle. Throughout the work, Teresa develops a picture of the soul that is not opposed to the intellect, but, on the other hand, appreciates the distorting effect the intellect can have on the formation of our self-image and, indeed, our relationship with the divine. This is most developed in the all-important fourth mansion of the interior castle, the hinge, if you like, on which the whole schema of the castle turns. In the previous third mansion, she had described the type of people who had well-developed intellect, but to whom, quote, "the inner doors of the castle are barred. They are fond," she writes, "of doing penance and setting aside periods for recollection, the recogimiento, which is so central to Pasuna's system. They spend their time well, practicing works of charity towards their neighbours. They're very balanced in their use of speech and dress, and in governing their households. After these years, when it seems they have become lords of the world, or at least clearly disillusioned in this regard, His Majesty will try them in some minor matters, and they will go about disturbed and afflicted, that it puzzles me and makes me fearful. Such a move from the understanding will be encountered, she writes, in the fourth mansion. And she states clearly here, as we a very similar passage to the one we heard this morning, that she cannot explain the process, but rather that she will show it. As these mansions, she writes, are much closer to where the king lives, they have great beauty. Just see. As these mansions are much closer to where the king lives, they have great beauty, and they are things so delicate to see and understand there, which the understanding does not have the capacity to grasp them. Although something might turn out to be well put and not at all obscure to the inexperienced, those who have experience, especially a lot of it, will understand very well. Her castle is not something, she says, to be thought, or something that appears in the mind, but rather it is something it shows itself or offers itself to our experience. Fourth, mystical theology as a savoury knowledge. One of the key elements of the Theologia Mystica that Teresa derives from her study of Osuna, and then ultimately from Gerson, is what Osuna calls the sabrosa saber, and he loves playing on the similarities of the Spanish words sabor and saber, to taste and to know. He calls it the tasty knowledge. Like Teresa, Osuna takes his cue from Psalm 23, taste and see that the Lord is good. And he keeps playing on the similarity of the two terms. This notion of the gustos and sabrosa saber of the Theologia Mystica is taken up in chapter 12 of the alphabet. No entiendo más gustando, pensé alcanzar reposo. Not by thinking much, but by tasting, think to attain rest. Knowledge for Osuna is derived not from knowing, but from tasting. In particular, tasting the delights of the gustos espirituales, the spiritual delights. So excellent, he writes, that it is almost impossible for a person who has experienced it not to praise it. In this respect, Gerson, Osuna, and ultimately Teresa depart most radically from the pure intellective Dionysianism of the likes of Albert or Eckhart. Eckhart's getting mentioned a lot today, isn't it? Their Dionysianism is one with a distinctly Gallic twang of saveur, goût, delight. This is Gerson. Sometimes it's difficult to think which is Gerson, which is Osuna, which is Teresa. He writes in the Mountain of Contemplation, one receives a sense of delight or spiritual enjoyment felt in the soul when God visits it secretly, after one has humbled oneself before His Majesty. And if this happens, then an ordinary person, when they receive some of the benefits mentioned here, will know God better than any scholar or philosopher. And he goes on, as many of them do, to quote the Song of Songs in this context. Although she states in the fourth mansion that the gustos begin in God, she refuses to say what they are, but rather resorts to showing them to us through the use of metaphor and analogy, just as she did at the beginning of the castle when referring to the nature of the self. The gustos, then, for Teresa, are like the words of the psalmist, cum dilatasti cor meum. They are an enlargement of the heart. They are like a trough of water, she says, filled by a source of water right there, without noise. There is no need for any skill, nor does the building of aqueducts have to continue. The water is always flowing from the spring. Which leads us on to the fifth one, Eros and Apophasis. The tradition of effective Dionysianism, to which Teresa, Osuna and Gerson were heirs, took seriously, possibly uniquely, in the late medieval and early modern Christian traditions, Dionysius' exposition of the importance of eros in the spiritual journey. Again, as Professor McGinn puts it, the Dionysian program is a cosmic one in which the divine eros refracts itself into the multiple theophanies of the universe, which in turn erotically strive to pass beyond their multiplicity back into simple unity. All movement in the hierarchy of creation for Dionysius comes from above and is, quote, fundamentally erotic. Not only do all things strive erotically for the beautiful and the good, as we hear in Divine Names chapter 4, but the deity itself is eros. Quote, divine eros is the good of the good for the sake of the good. Thus the initiation onto the spiritual path described by Dionysius is also an erotic initiation. Eros is the occasion for a special experience of knowing, in contrast to mental effort. This erotic apophaticism, another long phrase for us, or erotic Dionysianism, was famously developed in Teresa's own writings. As I've argued elsewhere, the experience of eros is central to Teresa's understanding of the search for union with the Creator. And of course, one very famous example of this is the incident described in chapter 29 of the life, the Transfiguration, of course immortalized in Bernini's famous statue in Rome. Again, I'm not going to read that out. I'm sure you're all familiar with that. But what's interesting about that passage is if we look at a strikingly similar passage in the Mansion 6 of the Interior Castle, of course written 20 years later, we can appreciate how Teresa is using this erotic tradition inherited from the influence of Dionysius to demonstrate the role of eros. And this is where I'm afraid I'm rather disappointed with Bernini. I mean, it is a wonderful thing, Bernini, but it has that statue, and you see it all over the place on the internet and everything. By the way, don't put in your Google the ecstasy of St. Teresa. Certainly not on a university computer. Yeah. But you'd be very surprised what comes up. But the trouble with that statue, it's completely taken the emphasis away of the passage and its references to the Dionysian tradition of the Eros. And when the two passages are juxtaposed, it's possible to interpret the passage according to Teresa's mystical theology. I'm not going to go through all the word-for-word comparisons there. Perhaps we can look at that later. What's interesting, though, is that, for example, in the passages she describes it, the flame of the cherubim, which is so essential for the Victorine tradition, and we'd see it again in the Cloud of Unknowing, where it's referred to as the dart of flaming love. This is clearly coming from that effective Victorine Dionysianism. It's used by Teresa, but she uses the word centella in this passage, which is her rendering, as I see it, of the cinderesis of the medieval mystical tradition, which I referred to at the beginning of the talk, the little spark, the place according to which according to Gerson, Bonaventure and Hugh Balmer, the place where the divine touches the human in the soul. This little spark, she says, gently touches the heart and causes the ecstasy of fire. It does not penetrate, as some of the translators, I think, mistranslate it. And although sexual connotations are present in the passage, this sexualized interpretation, like Bernini's, detracts from the fact that these passages are referring to the workings of the heart rather than anything specifically sexual. That's enough of that, eh? Finally then, mystical theology outside the cloister. One final area of confluence between Teresa's and Gershon's schemas that I'd like to draw your attention to is the emphasis that both make on the role of action in the world and the necessity for the contemplation of mystical theology to move outside the cloister to engage with the affairs of the world. Both Gerson and Teresa, as we already heard, were famously very active and practical figures, engaged in the most important ecclesiastical and political events of their times. And again, Philip II has already been name-checked today. Gerson, the reluctant chancellor, participated very actively in both the councils of Basel and Constance, making passionate and well-constructed intervention, which he was not thanked for the conciliarism he hoped would repair the damaged fabric of Western Christendom. Teresa, meanwhile, responded to the world in flames, as she calls it, with the need to reform and establish her, quote, dovecotes of prayer across the Iberian Peninsula. The spiritual search for Teresa cannot be an end in itself, but as she insists at the end of the interior castle, the aim of prayer, contemplation, and union is good works. And in this very famous passage, which I will read out, she writes, "This is the reason for prayer, my daughters, the purpose of the spiritual marriage. The birth always of good works, good works. I repeat, it's necessary that your foundation consists of more than prayer and contemplation. If you do not strive for virtues and practice them, you will always be dwarfs." Not very PC. Gerson's approach is slightly more pastoral than Teresa's. In the mountain of contemplation, he feels that the personality of something, he's very good on this, he's an excellent pastor. He feels that the personality of sun seekers will suit them more to the contemplative life, and to others to the active life. Some, he writes, are of such a disposition that they have difficulty in overcoming or taming themselves, and should avoid the contemplative life, whilst others, on the other hand, quote, have already reached the stage when active life becomes a great burden for them, an overwhelming impediment to contemplation. Passages such as this, Gerson seems to anticipate Carl Jung's division of personality types, quite striking, between the extrovert and the introvert by 500 years. In common with Teresa, and indeed Jung, he emphasizes the need for the naturally introverted person, by temperament or divine grace, to develop the active side of their personality, and the naturally extroverted to develop their contemplative side. Quote, "Thus, in one person, it is always necessary that Martha be with Mary, and Mary with Martha." An analogy also made by Teresa, and in stark contrast to many late medieval traditions, such as in the Cloud of Unknowing, that privilege Mary's, quote, better part over Martha's contribution to the spiritual life. In conclusion then, I began the paper by endorsing McGinn's bifurcation of late medieval Dionysianism into intellective and affective. However, I've sought to delineate here a later flowering of that tradition that develops into what will become the later mystical theology of writers such as Teresa. Such a mystical theology holds much in common with the classic expositions of effective Dionysianism, as we've seen, and draws heavily on similar tropes, similes, and metaphors, especially as mediated through the works of the Victorines. However, starting, as I've argued, with Gerson, and mediated in the case of Teresa through Osuna, we see a new form of Dionysianism developing, that whilst holding much that is important in the later medieval tradition, develops it through such means as the development of a less technical language, emphasis on what we would term a more democratic and less elitist approach to contemplation, and a greater early modern emphasis on the role of contemplation outside the cloister in the world of action. Teresa, in particular, will take the Dionysian use of Eros and integrate it in a way that will set it apart from the more austere intellectivism of, say, Eckhart or Albert. To conclude then, yes, I think that Teresa is a negative theologian, but a negative theologian in the Dionysian tradition as mediated by Gerson and Osuna. Thank you very much.
Session, I had a sense that I did not think that Teresa was a native theologian, so I'm going to put the said contra in this disputation, the point against and the objections, and then Sarah is going to give the reply at the end to see who gets the degree. Peter shows the role of effective Dionysianism in Teresa very clearly through the line of Teresa, back to Osuna, then Gerson, then Dionysius. And Gerson is obviously one of the key mediating figures of Dionysianism to 16th century Spain, alongside other figures such as Thomas Gallus, Hugh of Balmer, and Henrik Hoel. In the manner of Peter's paper, I thought I would extend six objections to this view. Actually, I've got five. And see how that goes. So my first point is that suspension, which is the state of the cutting off of what Teresa calls the cutting off of the faculties, the state that signals the entry into mystical theology, the notion that is often made that this is a negative state strikes me as questionable. But it is often the reason why people think of Teresa as a negative theologian, is that picture of Bernini, that she's kind of passive, rendered passive, and her soul is cut off from contact with the outside world in a passive negative state. And it is often this that is allied with notions of her negativity. But if we look at what she says, it's not so clearly, I think, a negative to be associated with a negative state. So, for instance, at the beginning of her talk of mystical theology in the life, this familiar quotation, she says, "A feeling of the presence of God would come upon me unexpectedly so that I could in no way doubt that he was within me or I totally immersed in him." I think they call it mystical theology. The soul is suspended, in such a way that it seems completely outside itself. The will loves, the memory, it seems to me, is almost lost. The intellect does not work. Stop there. In other words, suspension is, to begin with, a feeling of ecstasy. The soul departs from its normal operation, especially in the higher faculties of memory, intellect, and will. And the will leads, while the intellect does not work. And that's recalls a nice feature of the effective Dionysianism that Peter was talking about. But how apathetic or negative is this state? Teresa is clear that suspension can be recognized as a positive feeling, a feeling of God's positive presence. The will is positively engaged, while the other two faculties are more or less cut off. It has negative effects in the soul as its in the body and the senses as its corollary. But in that case, I would rather call it a divided state rather than one that is to be associated with negative theology. It's a divided state, part negative, part positive, and it's one in which the positive feeling of God's presence, positive presence, takes priority. And to add to that, I think Teresa, as she says in chapter 18 of the life, where she says, "What I'm attempting to explain is what the soul feels, que siente el alma, when it is in this divine union." Teresa is charting a progress of feelings which can be positively discerned. They may be accompanied by other parts of the soul which are negative, but in this central part, there is a positive feeling. And she talks about also, as she develops, the expansion, the unifying of the soul around this centre so that the whole soul is renewed in what we call a positive anthropology, a very Augustinian positive anthropology. And that I want to say more about in my fifth point. So that's the first point, that suspension is a divided state rather than necessarily to be called a negative one. Second, Teresa's does have these interesting dialectical statements of unknowing knowing that she associates with mystical theology. But in my view, they remain unusual in her thought. They are not a defining feature. And later I want to contrast this with John of the Cross, a point further down my list. They're not a defining feature. They are passing and rare, though interesting and negative in their construction. So, for instance, you get in chapter 10 of the Life, carrying on from where I was, from the last quotation, "For as I say, the intellect does not work, but it is as though amazed by all it understands, because God desires that it understand, with regard to the things His Majesty represents to it, that it understands nothing." It's an interesting statement, and it's very similar to the one that Bernard McGinn quoted this morning, where we have all this understanding, not understanding, in the same statement. And I think the features of what I associate with negative theology are certainly present there. That's to say, there's a dialectical aspect in which the positive and the negative are, you make an affirmation, then you deny it. So you understand, but you don't understand. And these are closely related terms, so you're using the fact of dialectic, of affirmation and denial centrally. And also it has a performative aspect. Teresa chooses to say something like this deliberately. She's not merely, as Bernard McGinn suggested, she's not merely having difficulty expressing something, she's choosing to express it in this convoluted way. And I think that is a key performative aspect of negative theology. So here I'm very much agreeing that she imbibes the tradition of negative theology. And also, as Peter says, this is more of a pathé, a pointing to how you must experience this from Dionysius, than a mathane, which is a thought to be thought. I want you to enter into this experientially rather than simply think it. But on the other hand, I have to take the other view. And this is the most difficult point to refute, by the way. This is where I'm struggling, because these really are negative in their construction. I suggest that they are rather rare in Teresa's writings, and they don't define her anthropology, her understanding of the soul, in the way that John's is defined by a centrally negative moment. And she doesn't reflect on their value for her teaching more widely. She doesn't suggest that this is the best way to do spirituality. It's simply something that she uses occasionally. And I think, too, that behind what Teresa is saying in these statements, she is holding on to a what I call a primarily positive experience, that God is positively present rather than that we should use language to question that presence, and in that way to grow spiritually, as I see as a negative process. She's more in a positive process of gradual emergence of the growing sense of the positive presence of God. So those are my responses to that point. Then third, I think Teresa's negativity refers significantly only to the soul. She uses negative statements to talk about this dividedness that I'm talking about between, on the one hand, on the other hand, how I feel in relation to God. But she doesn't apply negative statements to God. She doesn't say that God, as in the tradition of the Dionysian tradition, is dark. She doesn't say that God is unknowable in her discernment. There's no point at which God cannot be discerned. God is always a positive presence. So when she says, for instance, in her one of her spiritual testimonies, she says this: "I see clearly that the persons of the Trinity are distinct, except I do not see or hear anything. but there is a strange certitude even though the eyes of the soul do not see. And when that presence, presentia, is gone, the soul is aware that it is gone. The how of this presence I do not know, but I do know very well that it is not imagined. And the difference between that and what I was talking about, that dialectical performative negative theology, is that she doesn't choose to question, she deliberately doesn't choose to question the category of divine presence. In more negative thinkers like John of the Cross, you have this notion of divine absence as essential to spiritual growth. She doesn't use that. Now, I should mention here that there may be a reason why she doesn't use it. Gillian Organ has, in her book, talked about the state of dejamiento, of inner passivity, which was associated with the alumbrados. So people who spoke of a negative internal state of total passivity were often accused of heresy. So it may be that as someone with the institution on her shoulder, she's always avoiding talking about God in negative terms when discussing discernment of God's presence. That's possible, but it seems to me that she'd find another way of saying it if she wanted to say that. She just doesn't want to go that way. She, in other words, is different from John of the Cross on this point. And that is my fourth point, then, is that if we compare John with Teresa, we find a different sensibility and a different use of language in relation to the negative. John's great metaphor, of course, certainly for the ascent of Mount Carmel and the Dark Night, is darkness. And darkness refers to both a subjective state in relation to God, where the soul feels lost and abandoned on the path to union, as he says in the prologue of the ascent, and also to God. God is a ray of darkness, he says. He says he's quoting Dionysius directly. That's a phrase that Teresa won't use, that God is a ray of darkness, or God is in any way a darkness. And the darkness here is one in which there is no continuing positive apprehension of God, at least at that moment in the spiritual journey. God's positive presence cannot be felt at this point. And I think further, John doesn't just think that's a transitional moment. He thinks it is a transformative tool to appropriate this sense of God's absence. Is a transformative tool. It's central to his notion of transformation. It is what brings us beyond both affirmation and denial in relation to God, to the coincidence of opposites, where todo y nada, all and nothing, where I experience the all and the nothing of God and myself at once, the total neutral dispossession. What I possess is what I do not possess, he says. This coincidence of opposites, he dwells on that. He thinks it's very central. Now, I'm not saying that Teresa doesn't have elements of complete surrender and dispossession. She thinks it's absolutely vital, there's no doubt about that. But she doesn't use this transitional use of absence and darkness to get us through to the point where we appropriate that. I think one of the reasons is that in terms of experience, she simply doesn't value the experience of impasse. This is a word that Constance Fitzgerald uses to interpret John of the Cross's darkness. Impasse. Impasse is a state where, to quote, the soul can see no way out of or beyond the experience it is going through. Impasse helps to dismantle, if it is positively accepted, this state of not knowing where I'm going, if it is positively accepted, not only not knowing where I'm going, but feeling that I simply cannot proceed. If that is positively accepted, it helps to dismantle the false self for John. It stops the self in selfing. It stops the self going on creating itself. it makes us fundamentally open to God. And I see this use of this state of impasse of John as a deliberately Dionysian, a very Dionysian use of the method of Dionysius, of going through negation to a negation of the negation, where impasse deconstructs the process which led to me getting into the impasse in the first place. I turn the impasse against the impasse. I say, well, if I can't do anything, then it's over to you, God. And that turns it back and sort of deconstructs the impasse, a deliberately Dionysian use of negativity. And I think there are reasons one could give from Teresa, which I don't have time to go into, why she would not like that, which you could use to build up this notion that they are different here. I think one is that she is very suspicious of negative feelings such as fear and misery. She actually uses these two examples, fear and misery being valued too positively in spiritual direction. Particularly for women, she says, she sees those as dangerous things to value positively in spiritual direction. So she doesn't want the impasse experience quite in the way that John does. And another reason would be to look at the difference in their use of images of Christ, that John's focus on the cry of dereliction, the my God, why have you forsaken me, is a moment that he sees as this moment of impasse where Jesus cannot see the Father's love. And that's the moment of transition, that's the moment he says the moment in which the reconciliation and union of the human race is brought about is when Jesus is most annihilated in all things. And so he sees our appropriation of that state as the centre of spiritual growth. Teresa, on the other hand, sees the cross as something that is always positively discerned as a companionship. Everything can feel against us, but within that there is a sense of God's positive companionship, that we should know, she says, how this true love never leaves the soul. And knowing that is vital to Teresa for all stages of progress. Whereas John, it's when we don't even know that, when that somehow seems under threat, that to give oneself to that is a tremendously important moment of transformation. So I think we see in Teresa and John the different directions in which the effective Dionysian tradition is taken, and how, in my view, perhaps rather conventionally, Teresa is not taking it in the Dionysian negative sense. She's taking other aspects of Dionysianism, not so much the negative, whereas John is more Dionysian. And my final point then, number five, is that Teresa's anthropology becomes more positive as her thought develops. So not only is suspension not a very wholly negative state, but it is not characteristic of union in her mature view. It ceases to be the marker of mystical theology in her later works. In The Interior Castle, she says suspension ends in the seventh mansions. Suspension is only to be associated with raptures, which are not the true union. Suspension occurs in the superior part of the soul and not in the centre. Union now occurs in the centre. Suspension is demoted, if you like, to the superior part of the soul. And the centre is where the mystical marriage of Christ and the soul take place. And significantly, it's where the union that is given to the soul overflows from God through the centre to all the parts of the soul. And she has these images of the whole soul becoming energised to go out and work with God in the world. And so this is, and she says that the soul's life is now Christ. This to me is about the most positive anthropology I know of in theology. And it would be very strange for me to call that a negative theology. Nevertheless, I can see there are issues about the centre of the soul and whether that is a negative trope. So that really is my little said contra. And one thing I'm pains to say is that Teresa is not less of a theologian for not being a negative theologian by phrasing it all negatively. It sounds as if I'm chopping her down. I think she's just doing things a bit differently from that negative tradition. And that if one thinks of these two sources in the tradition of Dionysius and Augustine interweaving with one another, she's more on the side of Augustine's positive anthropology than Dionysius's basically negative anthropology. And there I shall stop. Thank you.
Thank you, Andy. It's lovely to be with you. Fear not, this is going to be very brief, and if you're hoping for some triumphant responsio, the climax and supervene over the other two, what you're actually going to have is a playful divide and rule strategy. We've heard a rich paper from Peter Tyler and an incisive critique from Eddie Howells. Let me express my appreciative thanks to both of them. To a large extent, I agree with Tyler's contextualized reading of Teresa as a Gersonian mystical theologian, although, of course, she received this tradition somewhat erratically via Osuna, Laredo, and other Spanish intermediaries. I also have some considerable sympathy with a number of Howells's modification of Tyler's thesis, for instance, in calling into question how consistently and thoroughgoingly Teresa works with Dionysian thought forms. What I see as my task in triangulating their debate there is not so much to adjudicate between them, or even to add any new evidences from Teresa's oeuvre as such. I think they've covered the bases. Instead, I want to call into question what exactly this game of categorization is, and what set of concerns is causing our male exponents to disagree about. What exactly do we gain, and what is at stake in asking whether Teresa is or is not an authentic master of the negative way? And I take it the masculine may be significant if unconscious. Let me make just three brief points, which perhaps may serve to open up some further discussion. One, it would seem that the animus, even anxiety, behind the question, is Teresa a master of the negative way, harks back to the long-standing tradition of reading Teresa as a quintessentially female mystic, as opposed to an educated male one, as one majoring solely in affective bodily or psychological states, rather than purgative transformations of the intellect. And of course, there is still some truth in this characterization. But readings in the Anglophone world as various as John Chapman, Andrew Louth in some moods, and even the feminist Grace Jansen misleadingly hypostasize this disjunction. On this older reading, mystical or negative theology in the Dionysian tradition is solely the preserve of a male elite in the late medieval and early modern period in the West, and Teresa is somehow the opposite. And along with this presumption has often gone another, that Teresa's work is a parallel but sort of inferior, or at least less developed, version of that of her confrere and mentor, John of the Cross, who is, of course, a proper Dionysian mystic. That sort of hangs over, sort of half-cock reading of Teresa. Now, our two speakers today make neither of these mistakes, of course. And ostensibly are part of a new wave of scholarship on the Carmelites, which precisely aims to resist such disjunctive gendered readings. But what I want to probe a little is whether they aren't still, both of them, in some sort of reactive thrall to the very disjunction they seek to overcome. It is this that seems to animate Tyler's desire to show that, after all, Teresa is herself a Dionysian, though of an affective sort. And this, too, that causes Howells to equivocate on the extent to which he is truly apophatic, negative, or mainstream Dionysian. So what seems to be driving the debate is whether Teresa measures up, after all, as an elite Dionysian who would more normally be an educated man. Why can't a woman be more like a man?
Never.
To this I would reply that it is surely far more important to let Teresa speak for herself in all her sui generis eclecticism and insight, whilst certainly noting where she appears to have been influenced by particular texts available to her, and actually to be much more knowledgeable about some of this Dionysian tradition than she often pretends to be. It would not be in her interest to pretend to be, because of the Inquisition. Now, a Lacanian, I'm not a French Lacanian, otherwise I would be talking in riddles. A Lacanian would, of course, be particularly irritated by this undertaking, because it would appear to strip Teresa of her distinctively semiotic destabilizations of analytic categories to core. But even a non-Lacanian may feel that something is driving the debate which has already skewed our perspective on Teresa's remarkable uniqueness. A second point is somewhat related, and this is mainly for Eddie. Tyler seems to think that mystical theology, negative theology, and affective Dionysianism are pretty much synonymous where Teresa is concerned, whereas Howells spends much of his paper ramifying and distinguishing them and adding apophaticism to the pot in order to argue that Teresa is more a positive than a negative theologian and not, quote, very apophatic after all. I can see what Howells is driving at here, and he scores a number of really good points, but it seems to me that some muddles creep in when he fails to define negative theology clearly in the first place, and then actually applies several different meanings to it in a rather confusing fashion. Following a recent article on this point by Bernard McGinn called Three Forms of Negativity, I commend it to you, it's in a book edited by John Barker, Sciences and Religions, we surely first need to distinguish negative theology as a linguistic strategy, negating the positive statement, or even negating the negation, as in Dionysius himself, from negative theology as an ascetic exercise of detachment from false goals or desires. Teresa surely evidences both these interests, yet there is no need, as far as I can see, to regard either of them as incompatible with various forms of positive cataphatic linguistic commitment and or positive feelings of God's presence. So it's a false distinction that you need to choose between the two. First of all, you need to know what you mean when you're talking about negative, and then secondly, don't assume that you have to choose the box negative or the box positive. They belong together, the cataphatic and apophatic, most particularly in the Dionysian corpus. So I find it confusing when Howells here says that Teresa is not a negative theologian at all. The fact that she has what he calls positive experiences of God does not mean that she may not also be a negative theologian, at least in the two senses already distinguished, linguistic strategies and ascetic detachment. A third sense of negative might relate to the issue of suspension, which Howells also talked about at some length. Now note that suspension is for Teresa a temporary state rather than a linguistic maneuver or a long-term ascetic practice. And as discussed by Teresa in Life 5, it involves the soul being out of itself while the faculties are unable to function normally. This is indeed language quite similar to Dionysius' description in the Mystical Theology of a contemplative ecstasy, what he calls hypernoon, beyond the mind, and hence, by definition, unknowing or dark. Teresa seems to know and understand this Dionysian trope really rather well, since she explicitly calls it mystical theology at this point in the text. She's been reading Osuna, I think that's right. She's been talking with her directors. She really understands it. Again, though, Howells drives, I think, an unnecessary wedge between, quote, positive feelings of God's presence on the one hand and negativity or apophaticism on the other, declaring Teresa to have an optimistic, positive anthropology and thus not to be a negative theologian. But this is surely a non sequitur, since different strands of negative theology can happily coexist alongside other more positive features. And because Howells does not seem adequately or consistently to distinguish mystical states from mystical forms of speech, he comes up with rather odd statements in the full paper, such as, suspension is not apophatic. Well, that's a confusion, I think, because suspension is a state. It's not a linguistic manoeuvre. Or, quote, Teresa speaks of the will positively, while she is more negative about the other two faculties. I'm not quite sure what that means. That's a strange use of negative there, I think. In short, there is slippage here on the use of negative and negativity, which at least to me causes confusion as to whether Teresa is or is not a negative theologian. A fourth and final meaning of negativity is also thrown into the pot by Howells when he contrasts Teresa with the negativity of John of the Cross's Dark Nights, the sensual and the spiritual. These are, of course, closely related to the second meaning I've just given of ascetic detachment and purgation, but in John's treatment come with a highly ramified and searing account of the darkness that the soul must encounter en route to union. But the obvious contrast between Teresa's narrative of the road to union and John's does not again mean that she does not have her own armoury of symbols and strategies for describing that process, that ascetic process of deep transformation and detachment. Why then feel the need to conclude that she is cataphatic rather than apophatic, or that what she teaches, quote, only contains negativity at points? I have a hard time seeing how this assessment helps us to approach her genius and distinctiveness, especially when important distinctions between different kinds of negativity are blurred. Again, to me, the whole exercise smacks of a remaining anxiety about whether she measures up to some hypostasized version of negative theology that is already normatively in play. Thirdly and finally, there are, it seems to me, equal problems with forcing the disjunction between affective and intellectual Dionysianism to core. This is partly because how to decide which side of the line any particular author falls may often be hard to discern. Thus, contra Howells, I see John of the Cross, myself, this is how I teach him, primarily as an intellectual Dionysian, if you've got to choose, because on his view, contemplation is received, infused directly into the passive intellect rather than in the will. But there are other ways in which he qualifies as an effective Dionysian, given his emphasis on eroticism and the summation of love in union. Something similar, I think, could be said about Bonaventure's Dionysianism, which has both intellectual and affective dimensions, and so on and so forth. My point here, again, is not that the distinction between affective and intellectual Dionysianisms and their different traditions in Germany and France, as McGinn has shown so well, isn't enormously heuristically useful and revealing, but that it should never be used, in my view, as a kind of rigid classifier. It's a type in the kind of Weberian sense, but it doesn't mean that you either have to be one or the other. It is unique texts and people we are studying, not illustrations of preordained categories of distinction. To sum up, let me repeat again that these remarks should not be seen as an attempt to either favour Tyler's rendition over Howells or vice versa, nor to undermine the contributions they've made. Both, it seems to me, bring great new insight to the texts, and Howells's corrections are by and large useful reminders of matters that Tyler has chosen not to cover. I have three brothers, I've been doing this all my life. However, my main point to repeat in closing is that women mystics continue to be assessed, more or less unwittingly, even our enlightened times, as kind of false starts, approximations, or failed versions of their educated male contrast. And even when they are not so assessed, and neither of these good men have done that, they're doing the opposite. Nonetheless, there seems to be a worry that still hangs over the discussion about whether they can be reclassified somehow as affective Dionysians, and therefore, you know, still some form of female emulators of male categorics that are already existent. So, as we in this period, post-Derridean period especially, find more and more writers on mysticism wanting to create distinctions on different kinds of darkness and different kinds of mystical state. I want to suggest that this whole undertaking can at times seriously distort our capacity to appreciate the distinctiveness and the originality of the texts in hand. And this would go as much for John of the Cross, incidentally, as for Teresa. Is Teresa then a master of the negative way? Yes and no. But more importantly, she's ebulliently herself. As she puts it at the end of her mansions, I don't care what you say. What I've written is true.
It's a bit like a public version of the tutorial.
I keep having tutorials like this.
I thought maybe to get the discussion going, although hardly anything is needed by way of stimulus. Since Professor McGinn's name has been mentioned quite often by all three people, I thought it might be just interesting for everybody just to have a very quick reaction from you, Professor McGinn, about how your work, how you see this question yourself, since you've been called into play.
Do I need a wire? I have one principle for conferences regarding spirituality and mysticism, and I can reduce that principle to three words, and it's often a critique: too much McGinn. I'd like to thank all three of these speakers. We've had actually an exercise in Dionysian theology. We've had the sick, we've had the non, and then we've had the hyper question. We have to go beyond both affirmation and negation. I'll just make three very brief points that have occurred to me, and in a certain sense they echo a number of things that that Sarah had said. The first is this: no theologian is either affirmative or negative. All theologians in the Christian tradition are trying to combine in some way to wrestle with the problem of how we can speak and yet we can never really speak about God. So to try to put any mystic in one of these categories is fundamentally a mistake, just as it is a mistake to say a mystic is either an effective mystic or an intellectual mystic. It's always a question of both and, it's not a question of either or. And in that sense, all the terms that we use, even those terms of affective and intellective Dionysianism, are pedagogical labels. They're heuristic structures. They're notional knowing in Newman's terms. They're not real knowing. They're not knowing the mystic as the mystic is expressing the relationship of the positive and the negative and what goes beyond the positive and the negative. So we have to approach the mystics from the point of view of the reality of their statements, and not from the point of view of trying to categorize them as either a master of negative theology or not a master of negative theology. And that goes for male and female, as well as all of the mystics in the tradition. Indeed, I would agree with Sarah that the question has often been posed by male students to try to create certain kinds of categories and to marginalize certain of the great mystics. So I fully agree with that kind of approach that I think has come out of this. And certainly the Dionysian tradition is very, very strong in a variety of ways in the later medieval period. And the figure of Gerson and the figure of Osuna are very important in mediating aspects of Dionysian, both the cataphatic Dionysianism and the apophatic Dionysian to John of the Cross and to Teresa. I will say one interesting thing, though, that I discovered in writing on Teresa and writing a chapter just recently on the Franciscan mystics who immediately preceded Teresa. That is that I think Bernardino de Laredo is actually more influential on Teresa and Teresa's Dionysianism than the often cited Francisco de Osuna. When you really look at it, Osuna is mentioned first, but she tells us that she read Bernardino de Laredo. I found far more parallels, if you will, of possibilities of connection between Bernardino de Laredo's ascent of Mount Sion and what we can see in aspects of Teresa. So that's my little fervorino.
If I may, when Eddie was doing his, I was listing scholastically all his points in my refutation, and then Sarah just completely took the rug under my feet. So I'm not going to say those, but all I will say is that great arbiter of public taste, the Amazon reviews page. When you look at the reviews of my, if you want to spend amusing 5 minutes, go and look at the reviews of my book. And one of them, basically in gender terms, men didn't like it and women did. And one of the men write, well, Tyler has made Teresa an analytical philosopher. And I believe that we all create Teresa in our own image. And what annoys me most about Teresa is when she's reduced to this sort of spiritual mush. She's this sort of affected, ghastly, pietistic Teresa. And I suppose I've sort of set it, my aim this year has been to restore her sort of, her sort of teaching authority, really. And I suppose, so I'm erring perhaps too much on that side. So I accept the chastisement of Sarah with great, great good grace.
I'd like to echo that comment. So before the session, talking to Sarah, I was saying, well, we really need to explain to the gathering why we think what we're doing here, and we're not just mucking around. Because we're almost enjoying it too much for the sake of it. And that was great. But I think, apart from mucking around, we were. I did, as regards to that conversation, see that I'm part of, as a writer scholar on Teresa, part of the reaction against seeing her merely as the pious experiencer, where John the Cross is the theologian, and say they're different, but they are both theologians. We all agree about this, but it's interesting that is where the reaction is coming from. In having this little sort of nerdy disputation, we're trying to get at how she's a real theologian, and that's remains very important.
So we got. Oh, there we are. There's someone around it. I have to say with you.
It seems to me that it's one of the things that Teresa talks a great deal about that you have, none of you, said anything about. And that's all you said about suspension. But nothing about the huge amount she talks about her visions. Yeah. Her visions of bodily, visual, imagery experiences. And it seems to me that is... Well, I've been thinking as you're talking about the distinction that Charles Williams makes about the way of negation of images and the way of affirmation of images. And it seems to me that Teresa is, in that sense, very affirmative. And she's taking and looking at what happens to her in her, what we now talk about her psychology. And she looks with enormously detailed understanding and takes that into a theological context.
If I've got anything to say about that.
So I have a question to go with.
Okay, sorry.
That's right. Also about the deformation? So this is a question more to Peter. I was wondering, I like very much when you spoke about the influence of Gerson, and I was wondering if because you were speaking of Gerson, if you don't also have to speak with this debate that he had with Rusbrook and this difference of mystica speculativeness if it's not is not also related to another concept that maybe it's not eros that is at stake here and the negativity affirmation, but the question of Mina and love, and then we come to the beginnings, and then again we another canon that could be resurrected, because also the mountain of contemplation, yes, it is directed to the to women and to the question of discernment, as Diane Elliott point out. So I was wondering if when we go back to, not to Dionysius, but to Hedwig, for instance, we look of the Mina that means Mina, so the love that loves love, and if it's not a kind of total affirmation, saying the ultimate yes.
I'll just quickly respond to that. We can talk about this over dinner. I did make a little reference to that this will all be presented in the final version of the book, to that, and I removed it while I was talking because I didn't want to go on too much. But you're absolutely right. He's, a quote I gave from him about much advanced scholarship and great learning in God's law may be quite suitable for the person who wishes to come to the height of contemplation. Nevertheless, such knowledge blocks their pursuit. And his argument with Roosevelt carried on, as you know, into the 15th century, into the famous Turgenev controversy, where Gerson is using that. Now, there's been a sort of revisionist view of Gerson. There was a very good collection of essays on him that came out about 2 years ago, perhaps suggesting that that view that's presented in the Turgenev essay is not, actually Gerson changed his view towards the end of his life, and that would support what Bernard McGinn just said. Sorry to have too much McGinn again, but support what Bernard McGinn was saying, that, you know, each of these people holds both of the traditions in themselves.
At the risk of confessio of too much praise, I'd like to pay tribute to Professor Copley's three brothers. who kind of given us such a bomb. I couldn't help marvelling that, being accused of male categorics is a new experience for me, which I'm grateful for. But somehow you three embodied a few things for me. Number one, the biggest distraction in doing the prayer that she writes about, cataphatic or apophatic, is trying to think about it and explain it and talk about it. And so when you said, Professor Coakley, at the end, I don't care what you say, it's true.
That's quoting Teresa.
It is a quote from her. I thought it was you with your brothers, actually. This kind of thing, I couldn't help feeling that you embodied the doing of what she's talking about, rather than just spending all our time discussing with minor points. But the other thing also, you successfully embodied another part of her teach, I think, which is humour as part of the spirituality. I just want to say thank you. I thought it was a delight. Thank you very much. And I felt very great sympathy for letting Professor Coakley go last for you two guys.
I mean, I think that, by the way, this statement, this remarkable statement she makes,
yes,
at the end of the Dimensions, which has been remarked on recently by Susan Schreiner in her wonderful book on certainty in the 16th century, it's deeply problematic, because she is, she's admitting that at the end of the day she stands by her own experience.
Yes.
And of course this was also true of Luther, opens her up to the accusation of Lutheranism, a term of abuse. So this marks a kind of early modern problematic position where you no longer establish truth simply through appeals to authority, but you do it on the basis of what you experience. And this is not without philosophical problems.
Wunderberg, thank you for all of those presentations. And for me, the
Professor Tyler's and Professor Howell's actually do go together. Importantly, if one considers Teresa within another theological tradition, that of the Eastern tradition, culminating in a Gregory of Palamas, where we do have both the apophatic and the cataphatic, that with God's essence, that cannot be known. In his energies, he can be participated in. And I was struck by your comments, Professor Howells, that where we see that positive theology in Teresa, it's precisely where she senses that presence, that imminence of God, and increasingly in that second half of her life, the importance of a Trinitarian spirituality that enters into her writing, her spirituality. And if within that tradition she in fact doesn't become a very sophisticated theologian, doesn't necessarily have the same language as the Orthodox tradition, and yet maybe getting at how that apophatic and cataphatic do coexist without becoming a muddle.
Well, she isn't managing it in the same way as Palamas, who, building, as you know, on that distinction originally made in Gregory, necessarily for context, and then moving through Maximus and so on, has this, frankly, still remainingly problematic distinction between essence and images, which you know, opens up philosophical difficulties about how you relate the essence of images. So she doesn't get into any of that. That's not her Sprache. But what she does have is this, you know, wonderfully high notion of our capacity in this life to participate in the inner life of the Trinity, and that she shares with John of the Cross, and they're obviously mutually influencing each other in this. Mm. And the work that I'm doing on the Carmelites at the moment is really trying to reintroduce into our systematic armoury in the West a real hope that union in this life is possible. Mm-hmm. And you know, this, not even Augustine thought that, of course. It was a high point of this presumption. We have plastered that away as elitist, which is really laughable to Teresa. That was absolutely not what she thought. And I think we need to recapture this hope.
Yes, sir. So we'll leave it there, because in a few minutes' time, it'll be time for supper. We'll meet again here at 7:30 for James Findlay's presentation. I suppose this exercise in labels and the use of language reminds me of a famous syllogism that all dogs have four legs. My cat has four legs. My cat is a dog.
What do I think?